Welcome to Growing Closer to God. I'm Pastor Doyle Jackson of the Church Next Door, and I'm excited to be with you today because I believe there's a better way. That's right. I think there's a better way in life, and today we're going to unpack that with you. So welcome. I remember when my boys were little, and we went to a friend's house, and they were getting ready in their snowsuits, their heavy winter coats. And you know, normally I was like wrestling with them, trying to get their arms in and everything. Well, our kids and their kids were ready to go outside, and their dad threw their coats on the floor. Their kids put their hands in it, flipped it over their heads, and they dropped on. And I was like, you've got to be kidding me. Why hasn't anybody shown me how to teach my boys how to put on their winter coats that way? It changed my life because I realized that there was a better way. There was a better way to get those winter coats on my kids. Well, this week, I want to challenge you to approach life a better way, God's way. Jesus actually teaches us a better way to live. In Luke chapter 11, it says that the disciples came to Jesus and they wanted to know a better way to pray. They knew how to pray. They had seen Jesus pray. They knew about John's disciples praying. Prayer was a part of their life. It was part of their world, but they wanted to know from Jesus a better way to pray. Look at this scripture with me. It's in Luke chapter 11, verse 1. One day Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he had finished, one of the disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples to pray." Now, you know that prayer. I'm sure you know it. It's the Lord's Prayer. He begins to teach them, say, well, start with your Father in heaven. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In that prayer, Jesus invites you and I to start. He says, begin with recognizing that God loves you, that he's like a father in heaven, and that he wants to bless you, that God wants to pour out his best in your life. So when you and I begin to pray, we actually find a better way. When you and I lean into God and we ask him to help us, to lead us, and we ask for his will to be done, it transforms our life. So this week, I want to challenge you to pray the Lord's Prayer every day, because I believe by asking for God's will to be done, for asking for God's kingdom to come, that you will find a better way. We want to invite you to a better way today, right here on Growing Closer to God.
One of the mottos at the Church Next Door is pray first, ask questions later. Talking to God, that's what we're all about. My friend Louise knew all about the Lord's Prayer. She was a young, beautiful mother, and she was suffering from leukemia. Louise went to John Hopkins and was a candidate for special treatment. And when she came home, I was there helping take care of things around the house and take care of her. She was so sick, and we decided to pray together in the living room. She asked me, "Do you think I'll go to heaven when I die?" I said, "Louise, do you remember a time when you invited Jesus into your heart and life?" She said, "Well, I remember being in the hospital after serious treatment, and I knelt on the bathroom floor there. In my weak state, I decided to pray the Lord's Prayer. I meant every word of it, and I poured my heart and tears into that prayer as I cried out to God." I said, "Oh yes, Louise, you will have entrance into heaven. God heard your cry for his help. Do you believe that he would send Jesus to die for our sins?" She said, "Yes, I do, and I'm so thankful that Jesus taught us to pray the Lord's Prayer." So I want to challenge you to pray this Lord's Prayer 2 times every day. You have homework. You will find the Lord's Prayer in Luke 11 or Matthew 6, 9 to 13. Set a reminder. It will change your life. Why don't we practice it together right now? Let's stop along the way and personalize each section and make it real. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. So I love to stop here and just praise God. Psalm says we enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. So when you start by praising him for who he is, his character, then you will feel his presence. Try that. Try just whatever words come to your heart and that you know to be true about him. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So here, let's say, dear God, I want your will over mine, and I invite your ways into my situation. Teach me about your kingdom and your family. What about this? Give us this day our daily bread. So this is where we stop again and we ask God for anything that you need today. It could be food. We can ask God for anything every day. So I list out the needs for the day, physical or even practical, such as a schedule or an emotional need for peace and comfort. Just say, God, I need you today. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. So let's pause again and list anyone who comes to your mind, any hurt that you're holding on to, and next share any offenses that we've committed against God, any known sin between us. The last part, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So here I talk to God about my temptations and I ask him to set me free. Ask him, he can help you overcome. This is a place of honesty. And for deliverance, we see and know many evil things in our world. And so we ask God, ask him to protect you and your loved ones. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I love this ending because I know that he has the power. He has the power to move the mountains in your life too. And he cares about your every need. So don't forget, pray it twice a day this week.
Hey, thanks, Jennifer. That was awesome. You know, I'm Pastor Doyle from the church next door, and I think it's so important for you and I to understand the reason we pray the Lord's Prayer is we want to invite our own heart to align with God's heart. It's so important for us to know that he has a great way to live, and we want his will in our life. Now, let's think about this. Is there a better way for the future? Now, the reason I know that question is important is because people keep coming to me in this season when there's been so much turmoil, so many questions about life and how you and I approach life. I can't tell you how many times people have texted me, emailed me, or when they were with me, just say, hey, Pastor, can you tell me, are we at the end of the age? Is this the end of the world? What's really going on? This desire to know, are we at the close of everything that's going to happen? What's interesting about that to me is this. Jesus' disciples had the same question. It says in Matthew chapter 24 that Jesus was on the Mount of Olives overlooking the city of Jerusalem. Now, from my perspective, I've had the joy, the pleasure of sitting there on many, many occasions. There was times when I was living in Jerusalem and I was in college and I would just go to the Mount of Olives and I would sit there. I would sit at this Russian church, and it's the Church of Tears where Jesus wept over the city. And I would look over the city of Jerusalem and I would think about Jerusalem and how that is a historical place. It's a place in time and history, and that Jesus sat there, that it's real. And so when you and I open the Bible and we look at Jesus, it's not just a philosophy. No, it's connected to history. And Jesus connected your life and my life to God and to history. And Jesus said, when he looked over the city and the disciples asked him that question, he said, well, let me answer that question for you. Look at these verses from Matthew chapter 24. Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives. The disciples came to him privately. Tell us, they said, when will this happen? And what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? And Jesus answered, watch out that no one deceives you. So what Jesus does is in this passage of scripture, he gives us insights and he also gives us clues into what the end of the age would look like. Now, before I dive into that, forgive me, but I have to hit pause. And the reason I want to hit pause on this discussion is this. I know way too many people that when they look at the world around us today, they say this about God and the things of God. They say that God's ways are outdated, that you and I live in a scientific world and we don't need God and we don't need his rules. We don't need his restrictions. We don't need God's advice and input. People, whether they believe in God or not, right now have been asking me the question, do you think this is the end of the age? So let me ask you this. Why is it that people want to put God to the side? Why do they want to get rid of him? Taking God out of the equation is not really a good solution, and this is why. When you and I remove God from the situation, where does our morality come from? See, you and I become the one that decides what's right. The reason you and I need God's law, the reason we need God's input, is he gives us direction for the world in which we live. He actually is the one that can deliver us. That's why we start there. Look at Exodus chapter 20, 1-3. And God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. God asks you to follow his way of morality, his way of living after he set you free. He first sets you free and then he gives you instructions. That's because he has a relationship with you. That's why I think it's really dangerous for you and I today to try to get rid of the law and the prophets and to set aside scripture and believe that we can do it our own way. You know, the scripture again and again says that the people did what seemed right in their own eyes, and it generally got them into trouble. Jesus came to fulfill the law. Listen to it. Matthew 5:17. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law of the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. So when you and I accept Jesus in our life as the way, the truth, and the life, we're actually fulfilling the law and the prophets. We're fulfilling God's desire because we're putting God first and we're trusting him for the direction of our life. We are empowered by God to reach our greatest purpose in life when we trust him and we ask for his will, when we walk alongside him. So when you and I say, God, thank you for being the one that's redeemed me. Thank you for the one that's leading my life. We're trusting God and believing him. That's why we pray the Lord's Prayer. That's why you and I, we go to God every day. We say, God, I want your will for my life. I want your kingdom to come. I need your help as a father. I need your help as a wife. I need your help in my home. I need your help at work. I need your help at school. Okay, I want to take the pause off and I want to go back now to the end of the age and what Jesus has to say about the end of the age. So go back with me to Matthew chapter 24. Remember, Jesus is sitting on the Mount of Olives. He's overlooking Jerusalem. He's kind of prayerfully thinking about the city. That's why in one place it tells us that Jesus actually wept tears over Jerusalem because he saw that they were choosing another way besides God's way. Every time I tried to abandon God, every time I've tried to do it on my own, it got me in a tough place. That's how I ended up in the ditch, so to speak, and I needed God's help out. So when Jesus is talking to them in Matthew, he begins to outline for them what's going to come in the days to come.
So on Sunday night at the live outdoor worship service, two ladies came up to me afterward and we were talking and they said, how do I get ready for the end time? If we happen to be living in the end times, what do I need to do? I need some real practical help to get ready. What would you say to them?
I think that God instructs us about how we're supposed to live. And I think the three things that I'm focusing on right now is first, there's a way to stand. God wants us to take a place for his purposes in the end. That's why we're inviting them to pray the Lord's Prayer. Number two, God wants us to learn to listen to him. Because if we hear him, we can be aligned with him and do what he's called us to do in the last days. And then number three, I think that God wants us to participate with him. He wants us to be sharing the gospel. He wants us to help people in need. He wants us to be salt and light in this time. And so I think that's what he wants us to do. So I would say we need to stand, listen, and to participate.
So why do people all of a sudden, even the last few years, feel like the pressure is greater or the return of the Christ is imminent?
In Luke chapter 21 and in Matthew chapter 24, Jesus says, we won't know the day or the hour, but he does say we'll know the season. And in both places, he says, it'll be like a fig tree. He says, when you see the leaves beginning to come out on the fig tree, you know you're in that season. Well, we just crossed over into a new season, summertime. We know we're in the summertime season. And I think all the signs of the regathering of Israel and the lining up of biblical prophecy lets us know we're very much in that season, and the whole world has been shaken this year.
What do you think are the current signs of the end of the age that the Bible would point us to?
There's five key things that Jesus talks about in Matthew 24, and I think also in Luke 21. He says that the whole world's gonna be shaken. And so there's gonna be things that happen in the natural realm, in the heavenly realms, in the earthly realms, that are gonna shake the earth.
Well, the coronavirus has hit the entire world. So is that a sign?
I think that a lot of people have certainly said during this time, there's something more going on here. And I think people's own testimony is that this is a big deal.
So God at least has my attention.
That's right. And so
what are the other signs?
I also have like ethnic pride. So he talks about nation against nation, and we see a lot of that. And I think that's really how the racism gets stoked, because people start fighting to protect their tribe, so to speak, or their group or their identity. And then finally, I believe that in this season, we can expect people that follow God to be marginalized, set to the side. And that's kind of problematic, because we do increasingly see the world try to say that a godly worldview has no place in the world in which we live. And that's interesting to me. My grandfather, Lyle Davidson, my mom's dad, he was someone who really learned how to trust God. He always talked to me about trusting God through the Great Depression. Well, all through the Depression, he just believed that God would take care of him. He was into construction. He was a builder, but he also moved houses. He would work on road crews to build highways. He had this team of mules that could move anything, Jack and Jake. There's this story about Jack and Jake one day. He was called because they had a road crew near home, and they couldn't move this huge piece of equipment. And when they asked my grandfather, they said, "Do you think you can move it?" He said, "I know I can move it." Now you need to know, other men had tried to move this piece of equipment. They brought their teams of horses. They've brought their teams in, and they've tried to move it. And this great big machine that would make gravel couldn't move. But Grandpa comes up there and he hooks up Jack and Jake, and he begins to instruct them, and they begin to move the machine. Everybody couldn't believe it. He moves it, and they tell him to stop. That's where we need it. And so he leaves it there, and they said, "Don't go away. We're gonna need it to be moved in 30 minutes. He said, "Okay." And he walked over in the shade, and he stood under a tree, and he talked to some other guys like he was the mayor of the town. In 30 minutes, they said, "We need it moved." And he stood right there underneath the tree, and he hollered at Jack and Jake and said, "Let's go, boys." And they began to move that machine again. See, once you've seen God move in your life, you can see him move again. My grandfather had a confidence. He passed it on to me, and I want to pass it on to you, that God is the answer. No matter what season of your life, good times or bad, God will be with you. Jesus warns us in Matthew 24 not to be deceived, and he says there's a better way. There's God's way. Jesus alerts us, so he gives us a warning sign. He says there's going to be people that come along, and they claim to be the Messiah, the Christ. And then he also talks about how there'll be wars and rumors of wars and these kinds of tensions. Jesus says they're coming about because the world is becoming more and more tense, a difficult place. Look at this verse right here. "All these are the beginning of birth pains." See, a lot of people have asked me in this season, are these the birth pains? Is COVID and racism, are all these things part of the birth pains? I actually believe that they are. I believe that there's signs that are causing us to turn to ourselves. The whole imagery that Jesus gives, where nation will be against nation, the whole ethnic separation, where we begin to fight for ourselves and self-preserve, that's a problem, because that's not what God has called us to. God has called us to follow his will, to love our neighbor, be kind to one another. That's why we stand against racism as Christians. We believe that there's no place in that. And Jesus says, these are the signs of the birth pains, this increasing tension in the world in which we live. "At that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will appear and deceive many people." A false prophet is someone who claims to know the future, or someone who claims to know God's way, but it's not really God's way. "But because of the increase of wickedness and lawlessness, the love of most will grow cold." but he who stands firm to the end will be saved. So God, I'm asking for your kingdom to come and your will to be done in my family, in my home, in my school, in my neighborhood, in Central Ohio. Say a prayer every day with me and say, God, may your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, because that's the better way. In the book of Timothy, Paul writes to young Timothy and he tells him about what things will be like in the last days. But mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of the good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying its power. Have nothing to do with such people. Have nothing to do with this way of thinking. You and I are invited to be a kind of people that somehow finds the strength in knowing God to put others first. That's why you and I were invited to love God and to love our neighbor. The only way we can do that is if God has set us free from a self-centered way of living. I think one of the best examples of this way of living in your and my generation was Mother Teresa. And Jennifer's gonna come and share a little bit about her right now.
My secret is simple. I pray, Mother Teresa of Calcutta. She challenges me to see an aspect of God's kingdom, which is that he cares about poverty. In Matthew 5:3, Jesus said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Jesus also challenges us not to forget and actively participate in doing something about the needs that we see around us. In Matthew 25:35, it says, "For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in." Part of the Lord's Prayer, being in God's will and God's kingdom, is looking at the world around you through the eyes of his compassion. Mother Teresa, she believed that each human life had value and dignity and that everyone deserved to be held in someone's arms when they were dying because human life mattered. And she would go to the ditches and offer to help people dying of HIV or leprosy, risking her own health in the streets of India. She said, "As to my calling, I belong to the world, and as to my heart, I belong entirely to the heart of Jesus." Small in stature, rock-like in faith, Mother Teresa of Calcutta was entrusted with the mission of proclaiming God's thirsting love for humanity, especially for the poorest of the poor. She was a soul filled with the light of Christ, on fire with love for him, and burning with one desire, to quench his thirst for love and for souls. On September 10th, 1946, during the train ride from Calcutta to Darjeeling for her annual retreat, Mother Teresa received her inspiration, her call within her call. And on that day, in a way that she could never explain, Jesus's thirst for love for souls would took hold of her heart. And the desire to satiate this thirst became the driving force of her life. And so Mother Teresa established a religious community, Missionaries of Charity, dedicated to the service of the poorest of poor. She started each day with communion with Jesus, and then she went out and she found ways to serve him for the unwanted, the unloved, the uncared for. You don't have to be different for Jesus to love you. Only believe that you are precious to him. That was Mother Teresa. So let's take up a few challenges this week. Number one, we're gonna pray and personalize the Lord's Prayer over your life 2 times a day. And number two, pray that God's will be done in your life and release your will to him. And number three, act in compassion toward the world around you. Look for the poorest of poor and share his love and hope with them.
One of the exciting partnerships we have is in India. And it's so exciting because we got word from them that even as COVID was reaching their part of the world, one of our churches there and a team of people had gone out to provide medical support and help and aid. That's why we've built an orphanage in Africa. We help widows and orphans. We believe that God has called us not to just take care of ourselves, but to care for other people. I believe that Jesus is the best way. If you want to know, how do I invite the kingdom of God? How do I pray, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven? Then follow Jesus. In John 10, Jesus says that he's the door, that he's like the good shepherd. He's the doorway that opens you up to a better life and a better way. Follow him. Before we go, I want to invite you to say a prayer with me. You know, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, that same night he told them that I am the way, the truth, and the life. He went to the garden in Gethsemane and he knew how difficult it was going to be. And during that time, he prayed. He said, Father, if it's possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, but may your will be done. So here's a prayer I want to invite you to. I'm going to put it on the screen right now so you can read it along with me. Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus to give his life for me. Forgive me for living so selfish. I choose to trust your way, Jesus. May your will be done in my life. Let your kingdom fill our world. In Jesus' name, amen. Hope you prayed that prayer with me. And if you did, please let me know. You can text CONNECT to 614-412-2144. All I want to know is that you said, I prayed for God's will to be done in my life today, because we want to encourage you to keep on that. We'd also like to give you some tools this week to help you continue in your prayer life. If you'd like a little encouragement this week, a little help in praying the Lord's Prayer, if you'll text CONNECT now to 614-412-2144, we'll send you a link and you can do a study on how to say the Lord's Prayer every day. It'll be a help to you and an encouragement. Hey, every week on the TV program, we've invited another pastor to be a part to encourage you that there's a lot of great churches in Columbus. Well, this week, I wanted to invite the church next door to be a part of this. You know, I've been the pastor of the church next door for 22 years, and we want you to know we've been praying for you. If you would listen as I and the church next door prayed together this past week for you. Heavenly Father, I come before you today, and I just want to say thank you, Lord. I want to say thank you for a church as beautiful as the church next door that would believe that the message of Jesus needed to be shared throughout our city. I thank you for being a part of a community that loves people from all colors, all backgrounds, that believes that Jesus Christ is the answer. I thank you, Lord, and I pray that you would pour out your Spirit on our city. I thank you, Lord, that Central Ohio is a place which you love and you value, and that you sent your Son Jesus for us, that we might know the way, the truth, and the life. And all who wanted Jesus' blessing said, amen.
We also want to invite you, if you're ready to meet, to come gather with us. We're joining online every week, as well as outside. If the weather's good, we're meeting outside, worshiping God, and celebrating his love for you and I. Hey, thanks for watching. I'm Pastor Doyle Jackson of the Church Next Door. Have a great week.